Why watch this video? Because we're talking about how to escape suffering, how to escape the monstrosity of the present times. And you might ask, well, what's so monstrous about it? Very paradoxically, it's an attempt to impose a new civilization upon the planet. And why is that so bad? Because civilization is not an end in itself at all. As a matter of fact, true civilization is designed to make itself unnecessary. We're supposed to be able to transcend civilization altogether. So when you try to make civilization an end in itself, you try to make it permanent, you get into tremendous troubles, tremendous wickedness. You create a Frankenstein monster, which is what has happened here. This world has really been taken over by extraterrestrials. And they are obsessed with civilization. They're obsessed with how can we make this civilization permanent. True civilization is based on spiritual truth. And from that spiritual truth is woven a civilization designed to realize that spiritual truth ultimately. The civilization that is being imposed upon this planet now doesn't have those spiritual underpinnings at all. So it's become very materialistic, very consumer-oriented, very entertainment-oriented, very hedonistic, atheistic, all those kinds of things. And they want to try and make this permanent. So real civilization has collapsed, actually, on this planet. And that's a bad thing, because if you value civilization, it's a terrible thing. So the question is, what to do about it? Okay, is there an answer? Absolutely, there's an answer. What you have to do is enter into the mood of repentance, as I term it. What is this mood? This mood is a constellation. It is part dismay and part fantastic, what would you say? Such good news that you just are shocked. Part shocked by such great news, actually. Also dismay that you've ignored this great news for so long. It's a combination of feelings that really, when you feel it, you feel kind of silent. You don't want to say so much. It's pretty solemn, it's pretty quiet. That is why there are these places of worship built to be quiet, solemn places where you go away from the frivolity of the world, away from all the all of that stuff that is now constantly being pushed upon us. And you go into this retreat, and there it's encouraged that you feel this quiet, solemn feeling, and you're able to say, oh my gosh, what I really am is so incredibly wonderful that it's just astonishing. So we're positively astonished, at the same time dismayed and regretful that we've spent all this time ignoring this fact. So abiding in this feeling, it somehow lets it all settle down. We get familiar with it, and it moves us closer to the real realization. Really, it's bliss. It moves us closer to this incredible state of mind that transcends the world so entirely that what happens in the world doesn't affect you in any way. It moves you to that. So ultimately, that's the goal of civilization. And many, many, many have reached that, actually, throughout the ages. But now, that's no longer the goal of civilization at all. A very, very different goal. The goal of civilization now is to prevent that, is to turn you away from that, is to demonize it, and do everything possible to avoid the mood of repentance, okay? So here, we are talking about and practicing the mood of repentance. That's what actually, if you want to be saved, that is what you have to do. And it's a kind of a heavy feeling. You don't really feel like dancing, because you're kind of stunned. You feel a bit stunned. Now, I will say this, I had a realization today. And that is that all awareness is pure awareness. Pure awareness is the only awareness there is. And when I heard that, it just hit me like a wall of bricks. I mean, I just said, my gosh. And it just had a thunderous kind of effect upon me. All awareness is pure awareness. All awareness is pure awareness. So, if you're sensitive to this and you're prepared, when you say that, it creates sort of like a response to inside of you that's subtle. And it's just like, wow, what? All awareness is pure awareness. It's a profound statement, actually. Way more profound than we realize. It's literally the statement of reality. In fact, all awareness is pure awareness. There's no such thing as gradations of awareness. It's all pure awareness. And this statement can brings on a mood of repentance, very strong. Because there's something inside of us that hears this. Now, it's not our just normal everyday consciousness, the brain, in one ear, out the other, okay? We're not worried about the brain. Now, here's something else I share with you here, which is, again, astonishing. I put this into the mood of repentance. When I've said in other videos that the way to escape is extreme right brain, extreme. But what I really mean by that is there is a capability within us to view things completely holistically. As a matter of fact, truth is a whole. You cannot see it from the standpoint of parts. When I had the experience several Mondays ago of pure spaciousness, I had a complete understanding. It was a holistic, gestaltic type of understanding of all facets, as it were. The whole thing could see, it all made sense together. And then when I kind of, that faded off, now I don't understand it at all. And I can't get to it piecemeal. You have to enter into this totality, a total understanding, a total appreciation of it, awareness of it, as it were. We have that capability. I just call it extreme right mind or something like that. But what I realized today is the ordinary right brain is what's called intuition. And I have to say this, that intuition is actually how the ego functions. And this intuition acts in the following way. It tells the left brain, as it were, to go out and collect parts, pieces. And then the right brain then tries to assemble those pieces. It takes this piece and this piece, and then it says, I wonder what the whole looks like from looking at these pieces, and tries to project in its imagination what the whole might look like from pieces. And this is what's called intuition. Intuition tries to complete the puzzle of pieces. But that is not what we're spiritual at all. That is actually the ego. So the right brain, left brain dichotomy is actually all the ego. And it's the right brain controls the left brain, actually. It's the right brain that says, hey, left brain, go out and get me pieces. Go out and count and collect and do all this stuff that the left brain does. Objectify. Then the right brain says, okay, from what I have here, I've got this and this and this. Now let me try and construct a picture of totality from these pieces. What it's really trying to do, the brain, what we're really trying to do with the brain is to remember what it was like to be greater than reality. This is literally what we're doing. And we never were greater than reality. There's no such thing. So we're really trying to find a memory that doesn't exist. And the intuition just imagines some kind of memory, like a holistic memory of how was it to be greater than reality? How was it to be prior to all spaciousness, prior to pure awareness? How was it? And so it looks at, takes these pieces and then imagines what it was like. And it's all a fantasy. There's no truth to it whatsoever. So when I say extreme right brain, I mean beyond intuition. That's extremely important. Beyond intuition. It is not intuition we're aiming for at all. And what we have right now in the world is the deification of intuition, of the right brain, that type of functioning. It's always controlling the left brain, which is why I say the feminine actually always controls the masculine. If you equate the feminine with the right brain, the masculine with the left brain, which is, it sort of breaks down more or less in that way. It works out a lot in that way. It's always in control of the left brain. It's always telling the left brain what to do. And then it synthesizes and intuits, you know, some holistic idea of a memory or something. So, but we have that now. It's unprecedented control from that right brain intuitive type of thing, controlling the left brain in society and culture and everything. It's a takeover, a massive takeover. That is a trap. That is the worst trap possible, because we're equating this right brain function of intuition with deity, with knowledge, with wisdom, with truth, with realization, with spirituality. It is nothing of the sort. It's the ego. It is the ego. Beyond intuition, prior intuition, you know, not even equated with intuition, is actual experiencing of the totality. Actual knowledge, actual knowing through direct experience, through experiencing, is not a bunch of parts, but something that is seamless. There's a seamless knowing that is the real spirituality. So that's why I say extreme right brain, meaning beyond intuition. Intuition doesn't get it done. That's the ego. When we listen to intuition, we think, okay, I've got all these parts and I should be able to assemble these parts into an answer, into what is right, what is true. But what we're trying to do is remember, have a memory of a situation that has never existed and never will. We can never be apart from reality. We can never be prior to reality, never be after reality. We cannot be greater than God. We cannot take the place of God. We cannot do any of that. And so we're trying to have a memory of something that's never been and never will be. And so that's why our brain-based thinking is so crazy. You might say extreme right brain is not even brain at all. It's not even brain at all. And yet it can somehow overlay the symbols of the brain, and the function of the brain can still be there. All right, so we're not saying get rid of the brain or anything like that. We realize that all awareness is pure awareness. This realization then puts everything in a different context, and it's very difficult to explain, but all we have to do is abide in this, hearing this, and say, oh my gosh, all awareness is pure awareness. That should stop you in your tracks and say, oh, wait a minute, wow. Different way of looking at things, isn't it? A totally different way. All awareness is pure awareness. Just like all space is pure space. All spaciousness is pure spaciousness. All knowledge is pure knowledge. So there's no such thing as impurity in reality. There is no impurity. In terms of awareness, spaciousness, and we, in our brain, we can't figure this out. That's why I say abide in the mood of repentance. Your brain is just like, it doesn't know what to say or do or anything. But beyond the brain functioning, there's something that's aware of the statement and the profundity of the statement. It's not in your cognitive brain functioning or even intuitive functioning. This is beyond the intuition, which is why those who insist that the intuition is it don't go into this territory. They don't go into it. They try to make a faux spirituality, which is the world is now in swamped with this faux spirituality. That's what's happening. As the intuition is in charge, telling the left brain, hey, bean counters, go out and do this, build this, you know, take care of these pieces, that piece, I want that piece there, let's build a permanent civilization, a permanent society, let's build a utopia, that's all faux spirituality. It's not real at all. It's the ego. It's, again, desperate attempt to try and get a sense of what it was like to be greater than God. And there is no sense of that. No sense whatsoever. So the brain can't understand these things. Right brain, left brain. It just like says, ah, it's useless, you know. What is this? I can't understand it. That's fine. It doesn't need to understand it. There's something within you that does understand it. Some people call it the heart or the soul. Or, you know, there's some words can be given to it. It doesn't matter. But there is something within us. There is, you can feel it. There's something saying, wow. And it's not the brain. Very clearly, it's not the brain. You might feel like an aching throughout your system, sort of an ache, like, yeah. Whereas the brain, you know, it's just, if you identify too much with your brain, you're just going to think that, you know, this is boring, there's nothing there. But if you're able to just sit quietly with this feeling, and it doesn't matter what the brain says, if it's bored or not, it doesn't matter, because you're not bored. Just because the brain says it's bored doesn't mean you're bored. All awareness is pure awareness. That's a mind blower, isn't it? And again, we can't quite explain it. We don't need to. It should have an effect upon you. A spiritual effect. And the brain is looking for something. Forget it, what the brain is looking for, what it's trying to seek. It's greater than the brain can understand. So when we listen to talk, which comes from this place, beyond intuition, beyond left brain, beyond right brain, stating these incredible absolutes, it strikes a chord, it resonates somewhere within us, and we begin to be attuned to that. And we're not trying to add it up, we're just getting attuned to it, getting familiar with it, getting used to it. And what happens is, next day, you'll be able to get another insight which is even more extraordinary. And you're able to get used to that. So you go step by step by step. You get used to this way of looking, a new way of looking, a new way of considering the situation. All awareness is pure awareness. It's an astonishing thing because we've actually not been believing that for a long time. We believe it's awareness is all stratified into hierarchies and stratifications, all this stuff. But no, it's never been stratified. It's never been stratified. All that belief in stratification is to try and get a memory of what it was like to be greater than God. There's no such memory. There's no way to recall it. We're trying to call to mind what it was like, which is, of course, stating that it must have happened. If we're trying to remember something, you're assuming it must have happened. But this is just a trick that we're playing on ourselves. Saying, well, if we're trying to remember, it must have happened. No. So, well, why would anyone try to remember something that's never happened? What else can you do with this wanting to be prime creator? What else can you do? You can't actually be it. You can only stage this pretense. Oh, I'm. What are you doing? You know. Oh, I'm trying to remember what it was like. That's existence. We're trying to remember what was it like to be greater than God. What can God say? You know, you say, you can't remember because you never have been greater. You haven't ever been separate from space, pure spaciousness. So how can you remember what it was like? So if you want to keep trying to remember what it was like, then that's the brain. If you want to drop that foolishness, then abide in this mood of repentance, which is sort of a combination again of positive shock and negative dismay, like, holy cow, I've done it. You now see it and say, wow, this is just awful. Yeah, but now I don't have to stay in there. And so there's a positive component too. It's like, I'm coming out of it. I'm waking up. That's the feeling. I'm waking up. Wow. But it's a profound feeling. It's just this feeling of something so profound you can't even express it. That's the mood of repentance. Something so profound, it's just a wow. Then you don't even need to try and find words for it. You don't have to engage the brain much at all. You don't need to say, brain, how do you explain this? You don't know. Don't need to. So this is the actual remedy for these times. It is the goal of civilization to be able to sit in the mood of repentance, abide in the mood of repentance. That is, and if you look throughout civilization, those are the high water areas of civilization, of places that set aside for communities all over to go and abide in this mood of repentance. That is that defines a civilization, absolutely. It's not places to be singing and shouting and hollering and jumping up and down, and, you know, dancing and all that kind of stuff. No. Solemn, quiet and solemn. I mean, we may wonder why should we be quiet and solemn? It's not a negative thing. When you hear and are affected by the great good news that real teaching has for you, it's so astonishing. It's like I said in the previous video, we have this inner being within us and we thought it's been asleep all these years. We thought at first it was disappeared, and then we thought it was dead, and then we thought it was in a coma, and then we thought it was sleeping, and now we realize it was always perfectly awake. You know, it's an astonishing fact. Absolutely astonishing. And it causes a sense of sobriety in your mind. And you don't want to be singing and dancing and hollering and shouting and, you know, all this kind of stuff. No, you want something that's very quiet, very solemn. That's the atmosphere that you want. No hustling and bustling of the commercial world. You want a sanctuary. So we've built all these sanctuaries all over the world. And that is what they're for. That defines a civilization. Now, this new civilization would love to get rid of all of those places. Probably turning them into casinos. That's how they see it. Said, get lucky. Pursue luck. It's so tragic. We can't even really talk about it. What's going on? There's been this blueprint for taking over this planet for a long time. It's been worked on for so long. And that's what happens. In the Milky Way galaxy, again, they're saying there's about maybe at least 10 billion Earth-like planets as far as their placement in the happy zone, where water in that zone in its natural state is liquid, and where atmospheres can arise and, you know, organic activity can happen, etc. 10 billion. And so the scientists are also saying there's, you know, aliens very likely exist. They're saying, yeah, of course they do. Of course they do. So, coveting other planets, if you just realize it, it's like, of course. If, you know, if you're an alien, you look at Earth and say, I think I'd like to have that planet as a home. I want a second home. You know, I want that planet. You end up collecting planets, and so of course they are thinking, how can we make this planet a place where we feel comfortable, and we want to live here. This is our home. We want to make this our home, or at least expand our home to include this planet. Just like colonialism and all those things where they go over, they find an island, they find a country, they say, okay, we claim this country in the name of Spain or something, and, you know, Portugal or Dutch or the British Empire or whatever. We claim this territory, that's our territory. And so we want to be able to vacation there, we want to get the resources from there, it makes our life more enjoyable. That goes on a global scale, all over the galaxy. So, of course, their ETs covet this place. They want to own it. And there has been this, you know, they plan ahead to an extraordinary extent, and they have decided, you know, they decided we can take this place over, and it's how they do it is not that difficult, actually. They've been very successful in doing it. We're warned about that in the Bible. The Adam and Eve story in the Bible actually is a metaphor for how the aliens take over planets. And it's succeeded for them. So they're now implementing this new civilization upon this planet. And those of us who are aware of what the purpose of civilization really is all about realize this is hell. It's a hell. It's really just the worst thing imaginable. So we should have options. One of the craziest things ever is the idea that somehow, just because we are moving a body around in this world, that somehow we're stuck in this world, or somehow, you know, we have no options. Who said we have no options? that's completely good. There are 10 billion inhabitable planets in the Milky Way alone, Earth-like planets. And that's just not even counting the different dimensions, etc. I mean, how can we say, oh, this is the only option we have, we're stuck here? How crazy is that? It's completely absurd. So this planet has gone rogue. It has gone rogue. And of course people say, what are you talking about? We're becoming so civilized. It's not real civilization at all. We're becoming very barbaric. We're becoming very paganized. Very, very paganized. And the objectives are totally geared towards trying to keep on remembering what it was like to be greater than God. And there is no memory to be found. And so it's just a futile, meaningless, aimless wandering about, which means absolutely nothing. As Shakespeare said, a tale full of sound and fury signified absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. This whole existence signifies absolutely nothing. There is no memory of what it was like to be separate from reality, because we've never been separate. That's like saying, we're trying to remember what it was like when our being was dead. It's never been dead. So we keep having these epics of where we try to believe together that, yeah, our spirit's dead, our being is dead, and so how are we living with that fact? And the fact is that the inner being is just pretending to be dead. It's not dead. It's not dead. It's perfectly alive. So, abiding in the mood of repentance, it's necessary to get these insights and feel the impact of these insights upon your being. Like, say, oh my gosh, I really do have an inner being. Don't get caught up in the cleverness. The mind starts talking about all these spiritual levels and blah, 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 blah. Big danger there. Just feel the impact of these simple statements upon you. And whatever statement comes up for you that hits you real hard, just feel that. Just abide in that. Because once the brain gets involved, you get totally confused and turned around. the brain starts asking all sorts of questions and thinks it's got all these answers, tries to put it together. Intuition says, okay, I've got these pieces, now let me kind of throw some stuff there and see if I can, you know, hit the bullseye and come up with the answer and blah, 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 blah. Now, the answer is beyond what the brain can conceive or understand or even experience. Pure awareness has always been pure awareness, always will be. All awareness is pure awareness. All of it. No such thing as awareness that's not pure awareness. Never has been. So this whole idea of different consciousnesses, etc., is really, again, an attempt to remember what has never been. It's an attempt to remember what has never been. There's only pure awareness. So this is the real yoga, the Ati yoga, okay? The apex yoga. The talking about the real truth is a stunner. We know it's true, but it's also a stunner. So we have to allow ourselves to go through this kind of feeling like stunned. So a real civilization has all these sanctuaries, and people go there on a regular basis, and they're quiet, they're solemn, they're respectful, and they listen to a talk that calls to mind these profound truths, and they abide there for some time, and they do that on a regular basis throughout their life, you see. That's the spiritual path. And gradually they get to the point where they can accept this, and then they become aware of it. It dawns upon them. When the sun dawns in the morning, does it only dawn upon a few leaves here, a little bit there, a little bit there? Is it piecemeal and you need to intuit the rest? Is that true? But that's how the brain functions. The intuition will say, oh, is it dawning? Okay, tell me what it's dawning upon. I want a few things it's dawning upon. And you say, well, this leaf, that tree branch, that bit of ground there, it's dawning there, it's hitting the roof, okay. And the intuition says, okay, I got it. Okay, now that's enough. Now I'm going to conjure up and explain what it's dawning upon. What is dawn, is there? Whereas what we need to do is to have the full sky panoramic vision, as it were, and realize it's dawning upon everything. The sun dawns upon everything, right? All the leaves, all the trees, all the ground, all the buildings, everything, people, everything, when the sun comes up, it's dawns on everything. So that's what we're talking about, is in terms of realizations, is this sense of everything. It's all inclusive. It's all inclusive. There's nothing excluded. Nothing excluded at all. There's no parts. There's no seams to it. It's always been that way. And again, many have succeeded at this. So it's not like we can't succeed. It's a matter of just doing it. And it's not something that is being emphasized anymore, especially in the mainstream way at all. It's called, you know, humility, abiding, and repentance, humility. It's all those kind of things where you go to a sanctuary and you're not trying to show off there how well you sing or dance or pray or do any of that stuff. Everybody should realize you're there for the solemn mood of repentance, which is abiding in this astonishment. Mostly a positive astonishment, and also a feeling like, oh my gosh, how could I have been so stupid for so long? It's wow. You gotta get over it. You gotta forgive yourself. So attitude of repentance, it includes this forgiveness, sense of forgiveness, and a sense of accepting your great good fortune. Your fortune is so great, you feel like you can't even accept it. It's so incredibly great. So everybody comes there for that purpose. So you're not comparing each other from the level of the brain personality of, you know, anything like that. It's just an atmosphere that's supportive of that. That's what these sanctuaries are for. And then often there's someone who gives a talk who's repented and has gone through this process of repentance and is established in this truly seamless point of view, full sky point of view, all-inclusive point of view, naturally, purely all-inclusive. In fact, reality is purely inclusive, pure inclusiveness. There's no other type of inclusiveness. It's always pure inclusiveness. Everything abides in this pure inclusiveness, always. It's always the case. So realizing this is again, a stunner. So there may not be a whole lot of people in the world who really are into this, unfortunately. But there's certainly some, there's no question about it. There's certainly some that their whole lives have been trying to read, you know, and consider and contemplate the highest kinds of spiritual truths they can find. They're very, you know, say, hey, I know there's something I really need to focus on. And so at some point you get to this level where you realize there are no levels. It's the level of realizing there's never been any levels. But you don't get there until you exhaust your belief in levelness, until your belief in levels kind of, you say, wait a minute, you know, are they really all these levels? I mean, you start questioning the very nature of levels, you know, say, is this valid? Before you say, well, it must be valid. Otherwise, why would we be doing it? That's like saying we must have been greater than God, or else why would we spend all this effort trying to remember this? it seems crazy, right? As they say, well, we can't be that crazy. But actually, it's whimsical, pure whimsicality, and we can be that whimsical. We just like to pretend, you know, that we can't possibly be that whimsical. So it must be valid, must be all these levels and all this stuff, must be. Eventually, you start to sort of some sort of awareness, like says, well, you know what? Maybe there aren't all these levels. Maybe that's all just part of this attempt to remember what has never been. There's lots of levels to that, right? In fact, there's infinite levels because it's all meaningless. What can you do except make more levels and say, well, the reason why it's not working is because I'm at this level and I need to get to this level. That's why it's not working. So these are just excuses and rationalizations to stratify everything. And then you gradually, it dawns upon you, say, maybe this is so. And then you begin listening to this. The Mahati Yoga, or the Apex Yoga. Or the Holy Spirit clarity, the Christ clarity. There's lots of different ways you can, you know, say it, but it's really the realization there are no levels to reality. Never have been. The nature of reality is right now. All pure inclusiveness, pure spaciousness, pure awareness, you know, all of that. And the inner being that you within us all is never been asleep. It's perfectly awake. It just has its eyes closed, just pretending because we asked it to. Didn't want to scare us. So is it difficult? Not that difficult, really. It's really not that difficult just to kind of sit there and feel this sort of pressure on you. It's only difficult when you say, well, what do I do with my brain? You don't have to do anything with it. You may say, well, a brain is a terrible thing to waste. Only if you're trying to remember what has never happened, then, you know, you want to use your brain because your brain seems to be doing all this activity and counting and stratifying and intuiting and thinking, okay, what's the next step? How do I get to the next step and all this stuff? It seems relevant. But we realize there are no steps, there are no levels, then it's irrelevant. We don't need all that mental activity. It's not necessary anymore. The brain has to say, not interested. Been there, done that. There are no levels. Are no levels at all. Never been any levels. But we needed to imagine that we're climbing all these levels just because the continuity issue, we're so familiar with thinking that, yeah, we, you know, here's something else that came up today. The use of the brain provides us with this belief in status, in remembering what our experience of being greater than God. And so the more we want to remember this, what never happened, the more we use our brain, the more we get into our brain functioning, and it goes faster and faster and more acute, and we're totally into our brain, function of the brain, because that we think that proves that we are, you know, doing a great deal of remembrance, which then we then believe gives us high status. We say, you know, I need to attain this high status in being prior to reality. So the more I work to remember it, the higher status I'm gaining. So if we don't use our brain, we think we're losing status in this imaginary reality prior to reality. We feel like, oh my gosh, I'm going to be lowly in this. Everybody else has a better remembrance than I do. So that's very intimidating. We think, I got to use my brain. I got to use my brain. Otherwise, I'm going to be low status. I'll be nothing. Of course, this is all ludicrous. There is no such memory of what never happened. So how could there be any status? There's no status. But we all have bought into this so much that it seems like those who are using their brain are gaining higher status. Certainly in our civilization, society, that's how it's set up now. The more you are into calculation and then intuiting how to tie calculation together into some sort of civilization, the higher status you have, the more you're using your brain, the higher status. And those who sit by quietly in sanctuary and don't even pay attention to their brain functioning, they seem to be, oh, they're the rejects. They're going to be the sudras, the street sweepers. As a matter of fact, people are so into remembering what has never happened and the status thing that those like myself who are not using their brain much and are biting literally get placed into the sudra positions of like being street sweepers, etc., picking up trash, literally. Because that helps, they think that's helping them remember. They say, yeah, I remember in reality those who have a poor remembrance of it, they're low status. Yeah, so this helps me remember. That's what they're thinking. Seeing that person in a low status really helps me remember. So they want to keep me in such a low status, you see, to help them remember what has never happened. But that doesn't help them at all. It actually delays them. You know, for me, being in such a low status position, it's not helpful. It's not helpful at all, actually. It's a lose-lose situation. But they insist, oh, no, that's very helpful seeing you there, because you obviously you have a very low capacity to remember us being greater than God. So that must be because you have a low status in this other reality. It must be. So we want to see you in that low status position to help us remember. Crazy. But that's the dynamic that in this world. And they said to Jesus, you got no status at all. In fact, we want you dead. That'll help us remember how we were greater than God at some point. That's how they want to remember. They want to remember Jesus crucified, dead, crucified, saying, ah, that helps me remember when I was greater than God and I had the power of life and death over God. So, see, they don't want him. You see, oh, Jesus must have zero status. In fact, he wasn't even there. He was dead. Not even a street sweeper, but dead. Of course, when Jesus resurrected, the people said, uh-oh, that doesn't fit in with our memories. Doesn't help us remember very well. Well, something's gone cuckoo, you know, and they stunned them, and they went into a mood of repentance. And Jesus said, you need to repent. If you want to see the kingdom of heaven, you need to repent. If you want to see pure awareness, pure spaciousness, pure inclusiveness, you need to repent. You need to accept this astonishing truth of what's been going on, what you've been trying to do. Trying to remember an experience that you never had, never can have. And all the madness, the folly, the whim that this entails. So, it's not good for me to be in such an incredibly lonely position, society, civilization-wise. So, I'd like to turn that around for sure. But people then say, you're not being helpful at all. Well, yeah, those who are trying to continue on with their folly, their whimsicality, will say that, of course. So, you know, I don't see you helping me at all. You're hurting. You're not helping us remember what it was like to be greater than God. And I say, I'm helping, encouraging you to turn around and enter the mood of repentance, which is all necessary for you. Because the astonishing fact is, you know, that you never were greater than God. And everything is always exactly the same as it's always been. There are no levels, you know, and the inner being has never been harmed. You never harmed anything. All this stuff is the food of repentance. That is the way to be freed from this Frankenstein nightmare, getting worse exponentially by the minute on this planet. Don't be locked into this chain, this prison house of civilization, which is fake civilization. It's not really civilization, it's all hedonistic, dystopian paradise. That just ends up with a feeling of bizarre ennui that you can't even have no idea what it's about, because you can't remember what it was like to be greater than God. There's no experience to remember, so you go into this attenuated state where you just simply don't even know. You feel so lost and I don't even know the words for it, but it's a terrible, terrible kind of limbo land of meaninglessness and aimlessness. And you feel this dreadful sense of aimless meaninglessness, and you don't even know where it comes from. And you keep trying to get all the bells and whistles louder and brighter, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work. You take more and more medicines. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. You keep trying to manipulate the genetic code. It doesn't work. Nothing works, and you just feel, you know, so attenuated and depressed and all this stuff. That's what happens. That's what this civilization is bringing people rapidly. This non-civilization that is pretending to be replacing the old one because it's so much better. You know, those who are involved in this think that they're so much better, so self-righteous about how great this new world order really is. And in fact, it's just incredibly terrible. And blind leading the blind is what it is. So, simple answer, just abide in this mood of repentance. Very simple. You can do it any place, any time. Any place, any time, where you just be quiet. Don't pay attention to your brain, what it's saying. It doesn't matter what people are saying or doing. Just feel this, like, wow, there are no levels. There's never been any levels. Or some statement like that. And you can look at these statements, they're available, and just let it impact you, that's all. Just let it impact you. Accept the impact of it. Then you are literally getting free of this nightmare. And don't let the brain say, well, how are you doing it? Now forget it. Don't get involved in that. Because it's a totality. The understanding is a totality. It won't be some sort of piecemeal thing with intuition trying to put it together. It'll be a totality. It'll dawn upon you. You know, how do we? They ask Jesus, how can we go dwell in the place that you've prepared for? Jesus says, you, when the time comes, you will know the way. You know, you will know. Don't worry about it. It'll dawn upon us. It'll dawn upon us. And like the sun lights up everything, you see, everything will seem clear and obvious to us. Not piecemeal. We won't have to be frantically using our brains to try to figure it out. Because we will have accepted this fact, there are no levels. So we're not encased in this prison. It'll just be a different perspective on everything for sure. No question about it. Subtly different perspective. And it will dawn upon us. No question about it. I can feel it. I can feel the dawn coming for me for sure. So simple. It's easy. Simple. And just don't let the brain try to interfere. Just don't pay attention to it. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.